Folate and depression. That's one of those crazy wifty things that you just see with internet YouTube doctors, right? Well, do you consider Harvard Health internet crazy weird YouTube doctors? They were talking about folate and depression, gosh, over 10 years ago. This is the Harvard Health letter. Folate for depression. It's the title. They go on to describe it as, yes, it's a green, it comes from green leafy vegetables, some citrus fruits and beans. It's useful in treatment for depression and other psychiatric symptoms. That's the first sentence. Folate or folic acid, also known as vitamin B9, is already known to be important for health. And they talk about CDC and WHO recommendations for use of folate for pregnant women to avoid neural tube defects. It's, as they go on to say, there at that point there was no proof, but many thought that it was protection against heart disease, stroke, and certain cancers. Since 1998, the FDA has required the addition of folate to enrich flour and other grains. Now, that's not exactly right. What they require is folic acid, which is seen by many as equivalent to folate, like methylfolate, but it's not equivalent. You have to have dihydrofolate reductase in an appropriate and healthy level and function for those to be equivalent. But we'll talk about that in other videos. The recommended dose is 0.4 milligrams or 400 micrograms a day, 600 micrograms for pregnant women. Older people may need higher doses because they don't absorb folate well. The evidence for a link between depression and folate levels comes from various sources. Along with vitamins B6 and 12, folate helps break down the amino acid homocysteine. Ring any bells? High blood levels of homocysteine have been associated with Alzheimer's, depression, as well as, again, heart attack, stroke, and some other cardiovascular problems. The breakdown of homocysteine generates SAMe, acetylmethionine, a major constituent of brain cells and some think a possible treatment for depression. Low levels of SAMe might explain any connection between folate and depression. And they go on to say, look, some people carry a variant gene that prevents them from making full use of folate in their diet. A meta-analysis published in 06 suggests that this variant's associated with schizophrenia, depression, and bipolar disorder. So there's also some evidence that people with low blood levels of folate are less likely to get relief from antidepressant drugs. So the point is giving folate itself for depression and other mental health disorders, as well as giving folate in addition to medications like antidepressants. They go on to say that the science at that time was clearly mixed. Supplements might give a boost to antidepressants, they might not. And here's how they ended up. Longer term research is needed, or may be needed, because some believe folate acts gradually and on a cumulative basis to relieve or prevent depression. The required dose is still uncertain. The main risk of folate supplements is disguising the symptoms of a vitamin B12 deficiency. Remember, we've talked multiple times about taking folate with supplements like vitamin B12. Thorn methyl guard was my previous recommendation for patients where I found high homocysteine levels. I just said, here, let's assume that you have methylation problems, because of methylation problems, I believe it's like 40% of us don't have it. The majority of us do have one type or another, or don't have optimal methylation. Now, according to, just one other point, the dosage level of folate in thormethylguard is something like 300 micrograms. I have recently been able to access a better level. It's about a gram. It's Restore Me, and we are offering that. I've been taking it for a few months. Because, again, as I said, I have a methylation problem. So back to the Harvard Health letter. Apart from that, dose is much higher than the daily recommended allowance, up to 15 milligrams a day, haven't been shown to cause serious side effects. Well, there's argument about that in the literature as well. But here's one of the things. Again, they're confusing folic acid and methylfolate. There's been less evidence of problems with folic acid at those higher levels. With methylfolate, you're just not going to see those types of high levels. It's just too expensive. Thank you for your interest. So I'm very excited to announce we now have a membership page. Now, what is that? That's the one place where you can go and access all of our digital products. It starts off with a few free things, like a lot of infographics, which help you understand the basics of insulin resistance, cardiovascular inflammation, and other key concepts on how to prevent heart attack and stroke. The next free item is the intro and first chapter of the book that we're writing on plaque. And the standards of medicine just aren't doing very well right now in terms of the number one killer and disabler, plaque. We don't do a good job of measuring it. We don't do a good job of monitoring it. And there are better ways. So that's what this book is all about. Again, go in and get a free look at the intro and the first chapter. And if you've purchased the cardiovascular inflammation and IR courses, thank you so much for doing that. You purchased those at a time before we had them totally cleaned up, and we've cleaned them up now. And they're available for you right there on the membership page. Hit the link below, register, and go in and take a look. Look forward to seeing you there. Thank you.